Since our focus today is on faith, and since it is Father's Day, I thought we would open with Faith of Our Fathers. If you use the hymnal, they have made the words more inclusive, and Faith of the Martyrs, but we will sing, because it's Father's Day, we're going to honor the men in our congregation by singing Faith of Our Fathers, and we'll be singing verse 1 and 3 if you're using the hymnal. So if you use the hymnal, you have to make that mental adjustment. If you use the screen, I've got it taken care of.
See it before. This is the boy of 4 years old who was in a severe car accident and had what doctors called brain shear and a deep brain bleed. The impact during the accident had supposedly disrupted connections in his brain. While he was in a coma for 2 days, the doctors told my daughter that Logan would probably be paralyzed on his left side, at least temporarily, and he would need to relearn how to walk, talk, control his body functions, and have other mental deficiencies. He woke up from the coma 2 days later and walked out of the hospital 5 days later with no neurological or physical problems. 2 weeks after getting out of the hospital, in his bedtime prayers, he prayed for angels to watch over his family. I'm gonna make it. When his mom asked him why he prayed about angels, he said he remembered that while he was in the hospital, an angel had touched him on parts of his body. He pointed those parts out to my daughter, and they were in the exact same places he had been injured. I don't know why God healed Logan, and others don't have such a positive outcome, but why should it surprise me now that he has so much faith, that he has an attitude that everything will be okay? Lord, help us all to walk our lives by faith and not by sight, to be sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Because of you and your presence in our lives, everything will be okay. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we are in awe of your presence. You are the one true God. Nothing is impossible for you. And yet we struggle to leave our doubts behind and put complete faith in you. Faith that you will care for us and provide for us, that everything will be okay. But things don't always seem to come out okay. What we hope for doesn't always come to pass. Forgive us, Lord, for our lack of understanding. Give us faith as a little child, putting our trust in you and your loving care, and being sure of the hope that we have in you. In your name, amen.
So would you stand as we begin our time of praise with some great favorite songs of faith? songs. Pastor Michael has suggested some, Katie has suggested some. And so I'm going to teach this song, Unashamed Love, today, and then we're actually going to sing it the next 2 weeks so we really get it good in our memories. So there's a lot of repetition with the line, worthy, you are worthy, so I think you'll catch on to that part first. We're going to sing through once, and then it will repeat, and you can join in as you feel ready.
Was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. The ushers, please come forward. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you are the one deserving of our faith, the one worthy of our hope. People trust you to care and provide for them. Help us to be part of your sustaining love and reinforce people's faith in you by sharing our blessings and our gifts, by meeting their needs in your name, and giving you the honor and glory, for all that we have comes from you. Bless this offering this morning, and may people's faith be strengthened by the good work it accomplishes. Amen.
Father, how long has he been like this? From childhood, he answered. It has often thrown him into fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. If you can, said Jesus, everything is possible for one who believes. Immediately, the father's boy exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. When Jesus saw that a crowd was running to the scene, he rebuked the evil spirit. You deaf and mute spirit, he said, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. The spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said, he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet, and he stood up. After Jesus had gone indoors, his disciples asked him privately, why couldn't we drive it out? He replied, this kind can come out only by prayer. These are words from God for God's people. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. God, we thank you for these moments this morning to gather together around the scriptures. And we pray that in these moments that your spirit would be our teacher. And we pray that the outcome of these moments would not be just that we gain more information about what the scriptures say. But we pray, God, that you would do in us a work of transformation so that more and more in who we are and in how we live, the life of Jesus would be evident. And so we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So last week, toward the end of the sermon, I shared with you a pattern for prayer. Just the word acts, with that first word meaning adoration, meaning when we are praising God for God's character, for who God is. The second word, C, for confession, where we are agreeing with God about our sin, when we're confessing our sin to God. And that word T, that letter T, for thanksgiving, where we are thanking God for the way he acts in our lives, for the way God is active in our circumstances, giving God thanks for that. And then that last S, kind of a weird church word, supplication, but where we are presenting our request to God, where we are sharing with God what's of concern to us. And so I sent you home last week to kind of try out that pattern of prayer during the week, and I reminded you about that on Thursday with the email, and I know at least a few of you have tried that this week, so I'm interested. Tell me what your experience was with that pattern. Anybody want to share?
It helped me to focus.
Yeah, helps you to focus, okay? Just to have a pattern to work through, okay? Anybody else? Yeah, okay, because sometimes your mind tends to kind of wander when you pray. Doesn't that happen to all of us? And so the pattern helps you to stay focused. Okay, anybody else?
I found that by putting supplication at the end, by the time I got there, I realized I didn't have as much to ask for as I thought.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And it's true. Like, I was so focused on the other stuff that I was like, oh, well, now I don't need ask for so much. It was really fascinating.
That when you give your time to focusing on God's character and focusing on God's activity.
And my own confession. And
Yeah, sure.
It was different.
All right. Well, I encourage you to keep going with that pattern for prayer in the days and the weeks ahead. Today we're talking about faith, and we're talking about what faith is and how it works in our lives, and we're talking about why do we need to have faith. And I wanted to show you this. This is a stool. We keep it up here. And it's a good stool. And here's the thing. I could tell you all kinds of stuff about the stool, about how the stool is solidly constructed, about how the stool is sturdy. It's got four legs, it's got those crossbars, it's got a good solid seat on it. I could tell you all about those things, and I would not have any faith in the stool. My faith in the stool happens when I sat down on the stool. But even then, my faith isn't entirely on the stool because my weight is still kind of balanced on my feet and I'm leaning forward. But when I pick my feet up off the ground, I have faith in the stool. I am resting the entire weight of myself on the stool. I am trusting it. I am depending on it to hold me up. That's the difference between faith and belief. We believe a lot of things about the way that our world is, about the way that the world works, about different kinds of stuff. We have all kinds of beliefs, and those beliefs are not bad, but those beliefs are not faith. Faith happens when we trust. Faith happens when we depend on something. Faith happens when we rely on something. The most important thing about faith is the object of our faith. The most important thing about faith is the object of our faith. And for us, the object of our faith is Jesus. He's the one that we trust in. Now, in the passage in Hebrews that was read for us, it says faith is the evidence of things that we can't see. It's certainty of what we hope for. But then also, and that's a great passage, I would encourage you to spend some time in that. It says some really incredible things. Like one of the things it says is that God didn't make the world out of stuff that already exists. God spoke the world, God spoke the universe into existence out of nothingness. And that's an important thing for us to remember. But the writer of Hebrews goes on, and the writer says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. Think about that. Because if our focus, if the direction of our lives, if the emphasis of our lives is on pleasing God, we want to please God, we want to be the people that God wants us to be, we want to be doing the things that God wants us to do. And the writer of Hebrews says without faith, we can't please God. And then the writer goes on to say, because it's necessary that those who come to God believe that God exists and that God rewards those who seek God. Think about that for a while. Without faith, we can't please God. So we often find ourselves in the situation of asking, what do I need to do to please God? What do I need to do to be the person that God wants me to be? And so the writer of Hebrews says it very clearly. The writer of Hebrews says, look, you need to have faith that God exists. You need to trust that God exists and that God rewards those who seek God. So that becomes the focus of our life, that we're going to trust God and we're going to seek God out. And of course, Paul says in Acts chapter 17, he says, look, God is not far from any one of us. As it's been written, we are God's children, we are God's offspring. In God we live and move and have our being. And so we know that when we have faith, when we trust God, when we seek God out, God says in Jeremiah, if you seek me, you will find me. And so we know that when we extend that effort to seek God out, when we find God, that God allows God's self to be found by us, and we can connect with God at that level of faith. Now that's great. That's encouraging. That's comforting to know that when we seek God, when we believe that God exists, that God allows God's self to be found by us, that God rewards us for seeking God. But faith is hard, right? Faith is not easy. There are a lot of things in life that happen to us. There are a lot of things in life that come into our existence that make faith hard. Because we look at the world around us and we look and we say to ourselves, well, you know, I thought that God was supposed to be running the world. I thought that everything was supposed to be happening the way God wants it to happen. But I look at the world around me and obviously that is not the case, because the world that we live in, I don't need to tell you this, is full of suffering, and it's full of evil, it's full of people doing terrible things to other people. And so we look at the world and we say, how can this be a place where God is in charge? How can this be a place where what God wants to happen happens. And that's when we remember the message of the kingdom, the message that Jesus came preaching when he said the kingdom of God is near you. And so the kingdom of God, we remember, is the space where what God wants to happen happens. And the kingdom of God begins within us, but then it flows out through our lives and through the lives of everybody else who has faith in Jesus, who has trusted Jesus, and his Spirit dwells within them. And so the kingdom of God flows out from your life and from my life and from the life of everybody else who trusts Jesus. And so the kingdom is expanding. The kingdom is growing. And that's what we pray for when we pray like Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we are praying for the kingdom to expand. We're praying for the kingdom to expand through our lives and through the lives of other people who love Jesus, who serve Jesus. But faith is hard. Faith is difficult. Faith is not easy. You know, a lot of times we hear people say, well, the easiest thing in the world is to have faith in Jesus. But that's not really our experience, is it? That's not really what happens to us. Faith can be hard because we look at the world around us. And we look at things in our own lives that trouble us, things that happen to us time and time again. And we say, God, why is this happening to me? Why is this going on in my life? And faith is hard. The good news is that when we lack faith, when our faith is troubled, when our faith is difficult, we have someone that we can go to with that. This passage that we read from the gospel where Jesus has just been transfigured on the mountain with his disciples, Peter and James and John, and they've seen him there with Elijah, and they've seen him there with Moses, and they've seen that moment when God covers the mountaintop with cloud and speaks to them and says, this is my son whom I love. Listen to him. And so they've had that experience, and they come back down from the mountain, and immediately these people come to Jesus. And there's this argument that's going on between the teachers of the law and some of Jesus' other disciples. And they find out what's going on. And there's this boy who's been troubled by this evil spirit. All of his life, the spirit has tried to kill him by throwing him into fire or into water. The spirit convulses him, causes him to gnash his teeth, causes him to foam at the mouth. And so the child's father brings him to Jesus. And the child's father says this, and maybe this is the kind of prayer that you and I often pray. If you can do anything, have pity on us and help us. That's a pretty common prayer, right? If you can't do anything, have pity on us and help us. And Jesus speaks to the Father, and Jesus says to the Father, if you can do anything, everything is possible for the one who believes. So Jesus engages with the Father at the point of his faith, and he says to him, look, I can do something about this. But you seem to have doubts about that. You seem to question that. You seem to be uncertain about that. And that's where we find ourselves all too often, is we bring something to God in prayer. We bring a circumstance in our lives into God's presence, and we say, if you can do anything, have pity on us and help us. And our circumstances have just ground us down, because the person that we love is not getting any better. Or the conflict in our marriage just goes on and on and on. Or the children that we had so much hope for don't seem to be able to get it right. They don't seem to be able to be on the straight path that we would want for them. And so our prayer is, if you can do anything, have pity on us and help us. And God engages with us. God engages with you and with me. And God says, look, I can work. But then listen to the Father's response. This is incredible. The Father's response is, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. Because you see, the Father is in the space that we all occupy. Because for all of us, our lives are a mixture of faith and not faith. Of faith and doubt, of faith and trust and lacking trust. We all have that mixture of faith and not faith that the Father has. But the Father does this right. He takes his unbelief, he takes his doubt, and he brings it to Jesus. And he invites Jesus to act. And that's what you and I need to do when we find ourselves full of faith but also unfaith. Having faith but also having doubt, we need to take that. And here's the thing, Jesus is not surprised by that. Jesus is not thrown off by our lack of faith. Jesus is not bewildered or perplexed by our lack of faith. Jesus already knows all about what is going on in your heart and my heart. And he looks at you with compassion and love. And so the exact right place to bring our lack of faith, our doubt, is to Jesus. And just to say to him, Lord, I believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. And when we do that, when we bring our doubt into the presence of Jesus, then we unleash the power of God in our lives. And God can work to grow our faith, to deepen our maturity, to convince us, to train us to trust God, to trust Jesus. And so I just want to invite you, there is some circumstance in your life that you're having trouble with. There is some circumstance in your life that you're conflicted about, that you're experiencing doubt about. And I just invite you this morning to do exactly what the Father in this story did. The Father in this episode in Jesus' ministry, just to take your doubt into the presence of Jesus and just to lay it all out, knowing that that is not a surprise to God, that God knows all about that. But just to lay it out before Jesus and to say, I believe, help me overcome my unbelief. We know that when we seek God, it pleases God. That God desires to show God's own self to us. And so bring everything that's in your heart into the presence of Jesus. Amen.
Stand now. Because we sing oceans.
Thank you.
us when, if you have a comment about the sermon, or if you have a prayer concern or an announcement, you can share that. Just raise your hand and Mark will bring the microphone to you. And if you just say your name as you share, please.
Marion, happy Father's Day to all men in our lives. And in honor of that, there's a special treat waiting downstairs. So please don't forget to pick it up on your way out today. Also, Rick is having surgery on July 2nd, so keep him in your prayers that everything goes well. Thank you. Lynn, I just want to let you know that I got word that Kathy and Ken Yoder are hoping to come up next weekend and be here next Sunday. As I'm sure Kathy would say, Lord willing and the creek don't rise. But just, you know, praying that their health continues to enable them to do that. And next Sunday will be their anniversary. So you can keep that in mind too. And speaking of celebrations, our pastor's birthday was Friday, so I think we should sing to him. So.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
So Nancy, I just wanted to highlight the announcement in the bulletin, a reminder that we have our family night picnic this Wednesday. It will be warm, but we'll have some cold beverages and some good food. There is a plan for the Moods homemade French fries also. If you could sign up on the sheet down the fellowship room, what we need most, if you bring something to share at the picnic, mostly we would need side dishes, and we'll have some nice cold ice cream for dessert, and also some leftover pork barbecue from the Meadowland picnic, so that'll be a highlight. All right, thanks.
Deb, prayers for me, Joan, and Lee. We're going to be driving out to Kansas for a wedding on Saturday. So prayers especially for Lee for being in a car with two women. Hope hopefully we'll find our way out. Yeah, so safe travels for us. And my other sister, Gail and Adrian will be flying. So safe travels for them also.
You see in the bulletin that we're continuing to pray for Cindy as she does therapy to get back after her brain bleed, and that we are praying for Judy as she travels, particularly with her getting acclimated to high altitude in Colorado. And we also continue to pray for the different places in our world that are experiencing war and conflict and natural disasters as well. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your presence. God, we pray for Rick as he anticipates surgery. We pray that that would go well and result in healing for him. God, we pray for Cindy, that you would continue to heal her. God, we pray for Nathan and Dana Good as they mourn the loss of their son. Pray that you would surround their family with your love. God, we pray for those who are traveling, that you would keep them safe and return them to us. God, we thank you that you are the God of peace. And so we pray for places in our world that are engulfed in war. And we pray that people would just recognize the senselessness of the violence in which they're engaged, and that they would turn away from it and seek your path of peace, God. We know, Jesus, that you are able to do more than we can ask, more than we can even imagine. And so we commit all these needs to you, and we pray in your powerful name. Amen.
If you'd stand for our final song.
Spirit. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.